But this presentation we're going to focus on, of course, Jefferson Airplane, and I really want to talk about their golden period. I think, you know, when they start in 1965, and then when Marty Balin leaves the band in early 1971, to me, that is kind of the end of this golden period. And I'm not going to talk, I'm sorry if you like the stuff they did beyond that. With, you know, in Jefferson, you know, Jefferson Starship, and, you know, that stuff, that's just kind of beyond the scope of what I want to talk about tonight. I have a lot of great video clips and some audio clips. I'm going to be doing some talking, especially in the beginning part, but we're going to really get a chance to see them performing a lot of these great songs that they produce. So does that sound good? Great. And I want to thank the library for having me here. This is a great facility to work in, so I think you guys are going to really enjoy this. So in the beginning, there was Marty Balin. Marty Balin is a folk musician in the early 60s in the Bay Area. He is with a group called the Town Criers. It's a really good name for a group with Marty Balin because he has this kind of sobbing quality in his voice. So he's performing this folk music, but like a lot of these folk performers in that period, there's a seminal event in pop music that's going to really change everything, and that is, of course, the Beatles. The Beatles play on Ed Sullivan. So many of these people hear that really lively, energetic, electric sound, and they think, I want to get that into my music. Then they hear the Byrds singing Bob Dylan songs, and they want to emulate the Byrds. And so Marty Balin really has that in mind. He buys a pizza parlor with some friends in the Marina District, and renames it The Matrix. And his idea is, this is gonna be a club where you can go see folk rock. And he wants to recruit the best musicians he can find to be in the band that it's gonna be like the house band there. So the first guy he recruits is Paul Kantner. He sees Paul Kantner, the great Paul Kantner, yes, and the great San Franciscan, at a folk club called The Drinking Gourd, which is actually just very close to where The Matrix is in the Marina District. And he said he took one look at Paul Kantner, and he said, I know that's the guy I want for my band, before he even heard him sing. Paul Kantner's a really good singer, guitar player, and a beautiful songwriter, and he'll be an important ingredient in the band. Another important person is Signe Anderson. She is the first female vocalist for Jefferson Airplane. They also meet her at the Drinking Gourd and recruit her to join the band. They've got a drummer named Jerry Pelequin and a bass player named Bob Harvey. And Paul Kantner knows a guy who's a really good blues guitar player, Jorma Kaukonen. Jorma Kaukonen, yes, Jorma Kaukonen, who he's doing folk music with various people, particularly on the peninsula and down in Santa Clara. So I've got this audio recording of him singing with a pretty well-known San Francisco person who you'll probably be able to guess who this is. So who is he singing with? Or is he playing with? Yeah, Janis. So this is Janis Joplin. This is, I think, from 1962, 1963, her first kind of incarnation in San Francisco music. Doing blues music. She'll actually go back to Texas and then come back when Big Brother kind of brings her back. And this is called The Typewriter Tapes, this song, and it's on YouTube. You can actually listen to it there. And they use a typewriter for percussion. So it's pretty cool. So Jorma joins them, and Jorma has this friend in Berkeley who has kind of funny blues names for people. And his nickname for Jorma is Blind Thomas Jefferson Airplane. And it's kind of an homage to Blind Lemon Jefferson, great blues singer from the 20s and 30s. But that's, you know, they're kind of trying to figure out a name, and they're just, you know, not finding anything they like. And then Jorma kind of mentions this nickname, and from that they get Jefferson Airplane. And I think that's really an important ingredient, having this really cool name. And it's a departure from the common names for bands in that period. Usually bands are named for like animals. So you've got the animals, you've got the, you know, the turtles and the beetles. And so Jefferson Airplane is kind of going in a different direction with this folk rock that's coming from San Francisco. So they start playing at the Matrix, but their first gig outside of the Matrix is at Longshoreman Hall. And this is a really famous evening called A Tribute to Doctor Strange. they play there with a bunch of other bands, including the Charlatans, and Great Society is there. And the cool thing is that people can dance around while they're playing music. Now, you might think, well, of course they can dance around. What's the big deal about that? But back then, you needed to have a dance permit for people to dance while you played music. The Matrix didn't have the permit, but this place did. And they look out there and they see their audience dancing. And of course, these are all people that are taking LSD and kind of doing all kinds of stuff. Dancing is going to be a really important part of what they're doing. And they're going to want to play a lot more gigs outside of the Matrix as a result. Another really important thing about that night is that Ralph Gleason, the jazz critic for the Chronicle, is there. And he really gets excited about Jefferson Airplane. He starts championing them. He writes about them in his column in the Chronicle, and kind of that helps build support for them in the area. Later on, he's going to write this book, The Jefferson Airplane and the San Francisco Sound. How many of you are familiar with this book or maybe even have a copy? This is a really rare book. It's only in paperback. And this library has two copies, but they actually have to watch you while you're reading them. So I did get to read this. So it's interviews with all the members of Jefferson Airplane, plus Jerry Garcia and Bill Graham. And it's really well written and interesting. So Ralph Gleason, really important figure. He's one of the founders of Rolling Stone magazine and a huge supporter of Jefferson Airplane. They've got bumper stickers and buttons. The Jefferson Airplane loves you. Maybe some of you saw that around San Francisco back in the day. So they have a lot of support in the Bay Area. But at this point, you know, we're talking like 65 going into 66. Not a lot of people are following them outside of the Bay Area. So there's going to be a bunch of personnel changes that take place with this band. You know, most bands are people that are like friends or they all live together. Marty Baron really wanted the best guys he could find for his band. And he was not shy about replacing people he didn't think were good enough. So he gets rid of Bob Harvey. And Jack Cassidy is someone who Jorma Kaukonen knew when he was growing up in the DC area. He is a really great bass player, and his bass playing is going to be very important to the Jefferson Airplane sound as it develops. This is a really important event in not just the history of the Jefferson Airplane, but in the whole history of Summer of Love. Probably many of you know about this event, but let me talk about it. So this is the Mime Troupe appeal party. What happened was, I'll digress for a second. The Mime Troupe, you know, they put on very left-wing political plays in San Francisco parks. They still do this. Has anybody seen them this summer, by the way? They did one called, I think, The Wall, which is about immigration and our dear leader. So they continued to do this. But back then, in 65, they did a play about the civil rights movement where they wore blackface and used pretty strong language. And the San Francisco Parks Commission was supposed to give them a permit before they could perform, and they revoke their permit. They don't like the content of what they're talking about. They need money they put on a play anyway. They get arrested, and they need money for a lawyer to defend them. Their manager is a guy named Bill Graham. Yes, that Bill Graham. And he puts on this party in November of 1965 at the Mime Troupe loft on Howard Street. And Jefferson Airplane just happens to rehearse there, so he recruits them to play at this party. Also, the Fugs, a New York band, is there. Lawrence Ferlinghetti is there. Yep, another great folk rock band. They charge a buck to get in, and if you don't have any money, you can like leave your belt, or you know, there's all these different ways of raising money, but they end up raising enough money to get a lawyer, and they will eventually be found not guilty on First Amendment grounds. But the really important thing is that Bill Graham realizes, hey, I love promoting music. And he's, of course, going to go on to be the most important promoter in rock history. So they do that. Here's Bill Graham. And they need more money, so they decide they want a bigger venue. Bill Graham makes a deal. He hears about it in the hippie community that they might be able to go to the Fillmore Auditorium. And he talks to the owner of that, an African-American man named Charles Sullivan. So they do a second concert in December of 1965. Great Society is there. So Great Society is the band with Gray Slick in it. So they're kind of seeing Gray Slick perform. And they raise more money at this and decide, wow, like the Fillmore Auditorium is a great venue. And there's some controversy about what happens next. But basically, there's supposed to be a meeting with people in the hippie community in Charles Sullivan about using the auditorium, and Bill Graham goes at like 9 o'clock in the morning to meet Sullivan when all the other hippies are asleep, and locks up an exclusive deal to the Fillmore Auditorium. So he kind of locks everybody. You know, everyone, if you want to use the Fillmore, you're going to go through Bill Graham, and that's going to really be a big part of the Bill Graham Presents empire that will emerge. And the Jefferson Airplane will play at the Fillmore many, many times in the next few years. So I think in 67 and 68, they will play over 24 times at the Fillmore Auditorium, often with the Grateful Dead. And a lot of these posters that we look at for Summer of Love will, you know, will feature both Jefferson Airplane and the Grateful Dead. So another personnel change, Skip Spence, I didn't mention him, but he became the drummer shortly after they start playing at the Matrix. But Skip Spence leaves. He's not really a drummer. They only pick him because they say he looks like a drummer. And he isn't really that comfortable doing it. And he leaves the band to start Moby Grape, which, of course, won't be around that long. And he's replaced by Spencer Dryden. So another important personnel change. And their first album comes out in August of 1966. They get a $25,000 advance to make this album, which was really unheard of at the time. I think it's a great album. It's really one of my favorite albums. They themselves were not that happy with it. They had a lot of fights with RCA, the record company, and there was some content that was censored and was not put on the record. But nevertheless, I think a lot of the material on it is really strong. And these are songs, remember, Grace Slick isn't with the band yet at this point. These are really Marty Balin songs. This is his band. And I think there's one song, Chauffeur Blues, where Signe Anderson really is the lead, but everything else is going to be all about Marty Balin. Of course, that's going to change later on. The hit song that's on this album, and we've got this video from the Fillmore Auditorium, is It's No Secret. It is a great, great Marty Balin song, and I'm happy to show you this video now from that. So that's how you get to see the light show, and you get a real sense of the scene at the Fillmore Auditorium. So we've got, the album comes out. The album doesn't sell that well, but people are really starting to notice Jefferson Airplane. And one person who does is the great Scottish folk rocker Donovan comes to San Francisco in the summer of 66, hears Jefferson Airplane, he's really impressed, and he actually kind of name checks them in one of his songs. So the most important personnel change for the band is going to happen in October of 1966. It's Grace Slick replacing Signe Anderson. And there's some controversy about how this happens. Signe had a baby during 1966, and she was traveling with the band with this baby. Her husband was really unhappy about that situation. So there's some who say that she decided to leave the band. Others think they were really impressed with what they saw with Grace Slick performing with Great Society, and they really wanted to bring her in, and they pushed Signe out. But the bottom line is Signe leaves. And the really cool thing is if you go on Spotify, or maybe it's available elsewhere, you can hear the concert on October the 15th, 1966, at the Fillmore Auditorium. This is the last night for Signe, and Bill Graham leads everyone in like cheering Signe and wishing her well. And then the very next night, October the 16th, Grace Slick starts singing with them, and you can hear those two concerts and hear how Grace Slick is when she just joins the band. I think she sounds like, you'll hear a little bit where she's trying to feel her way out, but I think in the course of that evening, there's certain points where she just has incredible charisma. So she really hits the ground running. So as we go into 1967, Summer of Love, the band is really firing on all cylinders. They're at the Human Bein on January the 14th. This, of course, is the seminal event. They perform there. Grateful Dead performs at that. Big Brother was supposed to be there, but apparently they got stuck in traffic. That's what I heard. Timothy Leary, Allen Ginsberg, Dizzy Gillespie is there. So kind of, this is like a really great event. And it'll be written quite a bit about. And there will be a song we'll hear a little bit later on that the Jefferson Airplane writes. Paul Kantner writes a song about this event. This, of course, is one of the great moments. To me, Surrealistic is the greatest album to come from a San Francisco band. That's just my opinion, but it is it's a masterpiece of an album. And what I love about it is the diversity, like it has such diverse styles on it. So they're doing so many different things. We always think of the Grace Slick songs, Somebody to Love and White Rabbit, which are the big hits that come from this album. But there's a lot of other things. So, for example, it starts off with this song, She Has Funny Cars, where you really hear Marty Balin and Grace Slick singing together and kind of weaving their vocals. So you've got that song. And then here's another song, which is very different, and it evokes another pretty famous California band from that period. Let's see if you can guess who I'm thinking of. And the flute, by the way, is Grace Slick. So who does that remind you of? Yeah, I'm surprised there wasn't a lawsuit. and then you have, here's a beautiful instrumental from Jorma Kaukonen. And another interesting thing about this album is that Jerry Garcia goes down with the band to Los Angeles to record, and he is listed on the album cover as the spiritual and musical advisor. Here he is giving some spiritual advice to Paul Kantner in the form of a J. And he is credited with coming up with the title of the album. So he apparently heard one take of a song, and he said, man, that's as surrealistic as a pillow. And they kind of looked at him and were like, there it is, surrealistic pillow. So, and he also is believed to have played guitar on several cuts and possibly to have rearranged Somebody to Love. Somebody to Love is it's a song that that comes from Great Society, Grace Slick's earlier band, but it's very different when played with Jefferson Airplane. In fact, we will listen to Grace singing this. This is from Monterey Pop. Boy, I'd love to know where Jorma got that sweater. That's a great sweater. That's Monterey Pop, and this, of course, is one of the most famous music festivals of the 60s. In fact, Jefferson Airplane is the only band that played at Monterey Pop, Woodstock, and Altamont, also did the Human Being. So they're the only band from the 60s that played at all these really milestone events. Monterey Pop was actually organized by John Phillips of the Mamas and the Papas and Lou Adler. So kind of Los Angeles musicians put this thing together. It was supposed to showcase Los Angeles talent, but it's really the San Francisco bands, among others, who gained prominence from this. So of course, this is a big event for Jefferson Airplane, also for Janis Joplin and Big Brother, not to mention The Who, Jimi Hendrix, and Otis Redding. The film that comes from it has a lot of Mamas and Papas in it, but these are the real highlights. For Jefferson Airplane. Another song that I want to show you guys from Monterey Pop is High Flying Bird. This is a song that they recorded on the Jefferson Airplane Takes Off album. It had Marty and singing with Signe Anderson, but in this, he's singing it with Grace Slick. And this is, to me, I just love the way they kind of go at it. There's almost a sexual energy of these two singing together. And it's really, I think there's a competitive nature to it. But it really gives the band a lot of energy. You'll also hear Paul Kantner singing in this too, but this is one of my favorite videos of Jefferson Airplane. That is great rock and roll right there. What's the name of the song? High Flying Bird. And it's a folk song a lot of other people did too, but I don't think anyone did it better than that. So at this point, this is, fall of 1967, a lot of people are noticing Jefferson Airplane's a big deal, and Levi's, our company town in the area, they decide to enlist Marty and Grace to help them sell blue jeans. So I've got recordings of a couple radio commercials for you. So first we're going to hear Grace.
Now, Jefferson Airplane.
So Grace wants you to buy white Levi's. What about Marty?
Now, Jefferson Airplane.
The most beautiful girl is the girl from Old Twig Sage, and her boyfriend wears stretch Levi's. She thinks he is something, really something, and she digs stretch Levi's. Stretch Levi's. She always kisses him and hugs him. They go dancing at the ball game. She looks great.
They're already ready for the aging of the baby boomers. They're selling stretch Levi's. So who wants to buy jeans from Grace? Who would buy them from Marty, girl from Twig City, right? So, by the way, they never did commercials again after this. They kind of heard this didn't go over that well. So this brings us to White Rabbit, you know, also on Surrealistic Pillow. I remember I was 4 years old in the Summer of Love, so I wasn't really part of the scene, but hearing this song in the 70s, and the first time I heard this, I was like, I heard it on the radio. I was like, you could play this on the radio? There was a company that their job was to review songs to see if they were appropriate for the radio called the Gavin Report. And they had like talked about the Bird song, 8 Miles High, and they said, "Don't, that's not a good song. That's a drug song. Obviously, it's got the word high in it." So that gets banned. This one, they're like, no, it's about Alice in Wonderland, right? So this is Grace Slick singing this on the Smothers Brothers. And I think it's lip-synced, but it's a little bit different from the album version. And it's a pretty cool video to see. Pretty cool having that on national television, huh? before they banned Smothers Brothers. That might have had something to do with it. So their third album, this is like 67, is a really busy year for them. They've got After Bathing at Baxter's coming out in November of 67. Baxter's is apparently a reference to LSD. That was like their code name for LSD. This album, I don't think it's at the same level as Surrealistic Pillow, but there's a lot of good songs on it. The one I want to play for you is Won't You Try Saturday Afternoon, which is a song about the human being that was written by Paul Kantner. Beautiful song, so let's listen to that. Oh, I have to also say, this is from Woodstock, so we're getting a little bit out of the chronology, but this was the best video I could find of it. And you might know that Woodstock ran way, way behind schedule, so they were supposed to go on Saturday night, but they actually end up playing this Sunday morning. You'll hear Grace making reference to that. I think this is from the extended version of the Woodstock film that came out. It wasn't in the original theater production, and the band actually wasn't that happy with this performance, but I think it's a pretty good one. Acid, incense, and balloons. Special moment in San Francisco history celebrated with that song. So as we move into 1968, they are really prominent at this point. They're on the cover of Life magazine. And this is also when they buy the famous house at 2400 Fulton Street. The house is white when they buy it. And they pay $70,000. They immediately paint it black. And they will own this into the mid-1980s, and then eventually they'll get sold. Today, it's white again, and it's $5 million. Sorry to bring San Francisco real estate into this discussion, but pretty cool place. All you are familiar with this house, I assume? Yeah, pretty cool place to visit between Arguello and Stanyan on Fulton Street. Their fourth album, Crown of Creation, comes out in September of 1968. This is their kind of most psychedelic album. You can tell from this cover. The one song we will listen to from that is Lather. Lather is a funny song written by Grace Slick. It's about Spencer Dryden, the drummer. He's the oldest member of the band, and he has turned 30 when she writes this song. So she's kind of, yeah, she's making fun of him for being 30 years old. I'm sure she cringes when she hears it today. And this is from the Smothers Brothers, and you'll notice that Grace looks a little unusual in this video. So we'll talk about that. Anybody notice anything unusual about Grace Slick's appearance? That was her. It was very tan. I'm pretty sure it is her. But yeah, she apparently put makeup all over her face to kind of be in blackface. Oh, that's really, you're right, it is kind of tan. And they didn't know that she was going to do this on the Smothers Brothers Hour, but they're like, okay, that's Grace. She's got to do something, right? Does she have... Well, she's American. Does she have an accent in her singing? Does anyone else get a sense of that? Okay. That's very observant. Saying it could be kind of an homage to Celtic kind of folk rock. Yeah. So 69, Volunteers comes out. Volunteers is their most political album and kind of galvanizing a lot of anti-war sentiment. We'll listen to a couple songs from Volunteers. It's a great album, one of my favorites. First one we'll listen to is We Can Be Together. And this is from the Dick Cavett Show. This, you'll see this video, a young woman with Dick Cavett. It is Joni Mitchell. This was done like right after Woodstock, and Joni Mitchell actually skipped Woodstock to be on the Dick Cavett Show. She wanted to make sure she wasn't gonna be late. Kind of ironic, since she's gonna write the great Woodstock song. But this is Jefferson Airplane performing right after Woodstock. I mean, for me, that is not a dusty relic of a song. That is a song that speaks to us today. Up against the wall, motherfucker. That is, by the way, believed to be the first use of the word motherfucker. Tear down the wall at the end, but up against the wall, motherfucker. In the middle of the song, which is believed to be the first time that was used on national TV. So, Grace Slick, breaking boundaries for everyone. The next video I want to show you is not the easiest one to see, and it is from the music festival at Altamont that Jefferson Airplane played at. How many of you have read Joel Selvin's book on Altamont? It is an excellent book, in my opinion, and really tells about the series of events, series of miscalculations that led to that tragedy. The key one that you'll see in this video was, you know, it was moved to Altamont at the very last minute, and the stage is very low to the ground, and as a result, and because it's not a very good place to put on a music festival, people are all over the stage. And of course, the Hell's Angels are selected to provide security. The guy you'll see speaking in this video at the beginning is an English gentleman named Sam Cutler, who was the manager of the Rolling Stones, and he's trying to kind of get order in this. You will see Jefferson Airplane trying to play their song, and then Marty Balin jumping into the crowd as the Angels start attacking people. So, yes. So it was originally going to be in Golden Gate Park, and Grateful Dead was doing a lot of the organizing of it. But then the Rolling Stones, who had kind of had this idea that they wanted to do a free concert, kind of take it over. When the Board of Supervisors find out about that, they say, well, we didn't know the Rolling Stones were going to be here. They say, we're not going to give a permit for Golden Gate Park. So they try to move it to Sears Point Raceway. But the Rolling Stones want to make money off of the film, and the people who have Sears Raceway say, well, we want a percentage of the profits of the film. The Rolling Stones say, no way. And so that's why, with only a few days left, they moved to Altamont Speedway at the end. And, well, this is what happens next. Oh, nope, sorry. Let me talk about something nicer, Wooden Ships. So you all are familiar with that as a Crosby, Stills, and Nash song. But those of you who are Jefferson Airplane diehards will know that Paul Kantner helped write that song, and it does appear on Crown of Creation. It's a beautiful song. But the Jefferson Airplane version is different from Crosby, Stills, and Nash because this is a song about surviving a nuclear war. And I think Crosby, Stills, and Nash song is just so beautiful, you might really forget about that. But here's an excerpt from the Jefferson Airplane performance of that. Yeah, this was written on David Crosby's boat. They were all, the three of them were sailing on the boat when they had this idea to write this song. I misspoke. It's on Volunteers, not on Crown of Creation. But really, really beautiful version from Jefferson Airplane. The two bands released that song simultaneously. So here is the excerpt from Altamont. I'll just let them take it away.
Stage who should not be here. Consequently, the musicians on this stage are playing with something like 200 people breathing down their necks. Now, can I please ask that everyone leaves the stage, and as I say, we'll go back to playing music and nothing else. The Jefferson Airplane. Jefferson Airplane.
It's all right. It's getting all weird up here.
Hey man, I'd like to mention that the Hell's Angels just smashed Marty Balin in the face and knocked him out for a bit. I'd like to thank you for that.
There's other ways.
Is this on? Talking to me, I'm going to talk to you.
I'm talking to you, man. I'm talking to the people that hit my lead singer.
You're talking to my people.
Right.
Let me tell you what's happening.
You!
Man, what's not happening?
Hey!
Oh! No!
I'll do all that.
No!
Stay on stage, man. They're not gonna hassle us.
You don't hassle us with anybody in particular. You gotta keep your bodies off each other unless you intend love. people get weird, and you need people like the Angels to keep people in line, but the Angels also, you know, you don't bust people in the head for nothing. So both sides are fucking up temporarily. Let's not keep fucking up.
This is the Grateful Dead. So that is kind of the flip side of all this. You know, we love each other, but this is chaos. And there was a lot of really bad acid at Altamont that was an ingredient picking the Angels to provide security and paying them in beer. Not a great decision. But, you know, I'm not going to end my presentation on this is a bummer, but it's kind of something we need to see. Yes? You were there and you had... So you were there, and you're telling us about your experience kind of far from the center. Yeah? So another perspective, you know, it's hard to feel good about something like that. I don't think they had screens, but I wasn't there. You guys were there. Were there screens? I think that was a problem. You were so far away, and it just wasn't a good landscape for that kind of a festival. That you know, everyone tried to press up to the front. Anyway, so the interesting thing is that Grateful Dead, who helped organize this thing, show up, and they're like, no, we're not. They just left. And you know, Bill Graham, who had nothing to do with this, really blamed the people who organized it and said, you know, you have to think about this stuff. And you can whatever you want to say about Bill Graham, he really obsessed over making sure things were well organized and safe. So why don't we move on? We're going to end on a happier note. I want to go back to Volunteers, the song Volunteers. And the story with that is Marty Balin was at 2400 Fulton early one morning, and he looked out and saw this van that said Volunteers of America on it. This was something kind of like Goodwill, where they would collect stuff. And he kind of thought, Volunteers of America, that's kind of who we are, who our generation is. We are volunteers. We're trying to save our country. And I have to say, you know, those of you who are from that generation, you guys ended a war. You guys did an amazing thing. And it's an example for all of us today to do what we have to do. So to me, this is another song, not a dusty relic, but a song that really speaks to us today. And this is a video, so you'll see a lot of different images as they play this. All right, we're Volunteers of America, right? I'm a volunteer, so that really speaks to me. So let's talk about, that's getting into 1970. In 1970, people start going in different directions in the band. On October the 4th of 1970, a terrible thing happens. Janis Joplin dies of a drug overdose. And the next night, the Jefferson Airplane is supposed to play here in San Francisco, and Marty Balin refuses to go on and perform that night. He's so upset about what has happened. You were at both those shows. Was that at Winterland? And this is really the beginning of the end. Marty Balin is really concerned about all the drug use he sees going on in the band. He's kind of, he had done that, but he's kind of trying to move away from that. And so he will perform, I think, in November of 1970, he will perform with the band, but that'll be about it for him. He'll leave the band. Others will join, will kind of leave what I consider the golden period for the Jefferson Airplane. They will continue to perform as Jefferson Airplane, I believe, for like another year or so. But then they'll go in different directions. So Grace Slick, she is no longer singing, but she does art. So this is a white rabbit she did with our newly legalized substance on his cape. Some of you know that really sadly, Signe Anderson and Paul Kantner both died on the same day last year. And it's a reminder to us that we really need to celebrate this music because these guys aren't going to be here forever. Good news though, Hot Tuna still plays, so that's Jorma Kaukonen and Jack Cassidy's band. They played at the Fillmore earlier this year, and they will, I understand they're going to there's going to be both Hot Tuna Electric and Hot Tuna Acoustic at Hardly Strictly Bluegrass. And I think on different days, that's what I'm hearing. So really cool, they're still playing. And I think Jack Cassidy performed at that event at the Conservatory of Flowers. So great that these guys are still at it. Marty Balin recorded this album that I happen to like. It's acoustic versions of a lot of Jefferson Airplane songs, and he's even got some songs he's written about the band. It's a little sentimental, but I think it's well done. And that is it for Jefferson Airplane, A Deep Dive. I want to thank you guys for coming out and celebrating this band with me.